Welcome to another episode of Coach's Corner. It's nice to see that you're available enough to come on your podcast. I appreciate your time, sir. You're a busy man.
It'll be my this is actually my third of the week, but it will be my fifth by the time this week is done. So for the antisocial guy, I'm doing quite well.
Well, it's still very much an antisocial thing because you did one in person. So I guess that's right. Okay. You did leave the house. You have been leaving the house a lot, man. I don't know what's going on. I don't know if we should have an intervention for you and Riley, but you guys are definitely out and about a little bit more.
So we were out in California at the Ironmongers meet, and it's kind of hilarious because, you know, it's a warehouse gym. So you'd be inside, outside, and then driving. We had to drive 30 minutes from like San Diego to San Marcos, wherever it is. And we went back and forth a couple of times. And just from the car ride alone, like my left arm and my left side of my head had like sunburns because the window. And Riley's like, are you really that pale that like 30 minutes of driving, you get a sunburn? I'm like, yes,
I am.
So this leaving the house business is dangerous for me.
It's a rough life, man. I remember one year we did the Kern and we took Sean Doyle, my training partner, nice pale gingerly man. We took him to the beach to go look at the seals and stuff. We were there 20 minutes. Yeah, he fucking nice. Burnt him. He burnt them all up. And he was so red the next day. I was like, oh man, it's kind of the same thing. Like just one arm or something had to hit the sun. 20 minutes, he was toast. So it's like, yeah, you pale skin people, man, oof, yeah. Rough life.
Us day walkers.
Yeah.
We're good for limited spurts, but you know.
But yeah, you guys went out to California. Looked like it was a lot of fun. It's interesting to see that California's doing stuff. They seem like they're one of the most restricted states, them, New York, New Jersey. And, you know, everyone's going back into lockdown mode, yep. Which is very, very disappointing. But I guess supposedly it's only supposed to be for 2 to 4 weeks. Like in Oregon, we were told, because we're in Portland, which is like the biggest, obviously the most populated city in Oregon. Every other county is closing for 2 weeks. Portland county area, Multnomah County area, was 4 weeks or more. And I hate when they do that. I hate when they say like, man, you know, there's some wiggle room. It's like, well, yeah, you said that last time and it lasted like 3 months.
3 months.
So yeah. It's very much, it's very depressing because it's like, you knew this was coming. You knew the second wave was going to be here. What? I don't feel like we're any better prepared for what's about to take place.
No, and it's not an effective strategy to lock down at all. We saw that with Australia. They locked down for 111 days, kind of thought they eradicated it. Now it's back again, and they're doing another round of lockdowns as well. You know, so 111 days, it didn't get rid of it. It's one of those things where literally you just have to have people who are high risk, tell high risk to stay home, tell them not to go out. They're doing it at their own risk to do things. Most of us in the healthy population aren't going to be affected by this long term, obviously. It's just business is more affected than health, to be honest with you. It's going to crush the economy again. It kind of sucks to see that. Yeah. It's one of those things where until we have effective vaccines and worldwide distribution of them, it's not going to go anywhere, no matter how many times you shut down or lock down. Curbing the spread doesn't kill the problem. It just kills the economy.
Well, I'm not an immunologist, but, you know, does the flu ever go away? Like, do these viruses ever just like go away? It's not like you're playing fucking hide and go seek and you're like, oh, we're going to go hide in our houses and then you're just going to vanish. Like that's not going to be the case, you know? So it's just a weird way to approach things. It's like we don't really have a solution in place. So this is the best thing we can do. And it's like, well,
yeah,
not really the greatest approach. But yeah, so this year a wash for small businesses. You know, who knows what next year is going to hold. It's a little discouraging. We were talking about is like, why would anyone want to start a small business? Why would anyone want to have any type of storefront when it just seems like those are the things that get shitted on the most? They're the most highly taxed. They don't get the tax breaks that the big companies get. They usually try to charge you out the ass to start a business. Like when we opened up our gym, they were like, oh, this isn't zoned for blah, blah, blah. It's going to be $15,000 and all you have to do is just put up a bike rack. I'm like, oh, fantastic. Like you just want 15 grand. I got you. And there's nothing you can do about it. Right. And it's very sad to see that because, you know, the American dream, right. Come here and start your own business and put in the work and the effort. And it's like, you know, you get these people and don't take offense to this, anyone, but you have these people who are like, I want to increase my minimum wage. And it's like, well, you just show up and do the same thing every single day. Why should you get paid extra when people who are trying to start a business and like work hard and they try to work more every single day to get it to grow and they're continuously having to do more and more. They're the ones that get shit on. It's like, well, you want to get paid more because you have to show up to work and do the same thing that you've always done. It's like, I don't really see how that makes much sense, but then, you know, and those are essential workers, but then small businesses, it's like, well, you're not essential at all. It's like, you're going to pay us regardless because you have this 5-year lease and you got to pay rent anyway. So we're going to get our money from you or you're going to go bankrupt. Not our problem. But these essential workers, like, what's essential? Continuing to make America obese. So we have to keep these fucking fast food chains open and all these restaurants open. But any type of health or fitness, those are like the first things to get shut down. The only thing in Oregon that's actually shut down completely is a gyms. It's like, the fuck does that make any sense?
The thing that keeps you young and healthy and able to fight off, you know, immunosuppressive diseases is what they've shut down.
It's
kind of counterintuitive, but that's just the way it is. Yeah.
And they don't talk about anything to promote health. They don't talk about anything to promote your immune system. And it's like, you know, how the fuck did Donald Trump get coronavirus at 75 years old, probably, or however old he is? I don't know how old he is. Probably one of the most unhealthiest people in the world. He fucking kicked 70, that shit in like a day.
Yeah.
Like,
they
know something we don't know.
Yeah. It was funny because I remember watching a story on the news. They threw everything they possibly could, any inclination of helping and everything and experimental treatments and the whole nine. They just threw everything at him. Like, okay, if this isn't going to kill him, it's going to help him.
And he fucking survived. It's like, man, yeah. I think they're holding out.
It's a tough road because we really don't know. And it's one of those things where there's uncertainty because we don't know that they'd rather be safe than sorry, which I get. But yeah, the statistics are showing us they're being a little bit over dramatic about it.
The uncertainty is what hits home the hardest, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah,
And then you're uncertain about when your gym's going to open, when you can make a living, what people are going to do. You know, right now it's a good time to be in the home fitness equipment field, that's for sure.
Yeah.
They're all sold out and raising their prices.
Yeah. Yeah. Which is another thing that I'm not a huge fan of. It's like, oh, okay, I see the world in crisis and I see we have an opportunity to profit, like gouge them. It's like, well, let's just raise all our prices because we know they're going to buy it anyways. Or it's like these fitness people who are like, oh, quarantine, this is going to be a great time to make some money. Let's do some, body weight workout stuff and we'll sell it for $10 to take advantage of people's misfortunes. I'm like, I'm not a huge fan of companies that do that either, you know? But neither here nor there. People do what they got to do. Everyone has their own morals and, you know, just because I don't agree with it doesn't mean anything, to be quite honest with you. It's just my opinion and I'm an idiot. So
you're not running the country yet.
Yet, exactly.
Working on it.
All right. So first question up, how do you know you're pushing too hard coming back from an injury or not pushing hard enough? This gentleman had an adductor hamstring tear, which we can both kind of relate to almost. Mm-hmm. I can actually relate to it. Mine's a lower abdomen / adductor tear. Had a nice little bleed out process, purple, swollen, the whole deal. 4 weeks later, he's squatting 135 comfortably. And now 15 weeks later, he's 315, but there's some tightness and soreness in the injured area. And he's trying to figure out, like, he was a mid 700 squatter. He's trying to figure out, like, you know, is this pain a good pain? Like the type of pain where it's like a newer muscle getting work that hasn't been worked in a long time, or is it the type of pain where he might re-injure himself? And I think that's just something that we can both relate to right now, recovering from injuries. But this one's definitely more in your wheelhouse because it's pretty much sounds like the same exact thing you've had to deal with.
Yeah, I blew up my sartorius and adductor magnus last year August, and I was about the same trajectory. It took me about 4 weeks to get back to one plate. It wasn't a pretty squat by any means, and the hip shift was significant. It took about 6 months for me to completely get rid of the hip shift or as close to it as possible. What he needs to be concerned with isn't the load per se, because the adductor's gone. it's the imbalance. Something is going to have to compensate for what the adductor was doing. And the adductor magnus's main function in a squat is hip extension out of the hole, coming out of depth. The hip extension comes from the adductor magnus predominantly. And so what I've noticed now lately as I'm working on it is my hamstring has to take up the slack, and my hamstrings were very deficient and weak compared to what my adductor strength was, obviously being a sumo puller and whole nine, my adductors were nice and strong. And probably too strong, which is why the adductor probably went out in the first place. But despite the fatigue management and the stress management, my adductor was doing more of the load that my hamstring apparently wasn't doing coming out of the hole as far as hip extension. So a lot of, as far as the training aspect, he's on the right path of doing a lot of volume, putting on some muscle size back into his legs and getting comfortable with the squat pattern. But he needs to really focus on some selective accessories or prehab work to help him with the hamstrings, such as, believe it or not, knee flexion, leg curls, making sure his hamstrings are strong and active and can handle the load as far as the eccentric load coming down to the hole, and single leg work to make sure that the hamstring strength isn't deficient on one side versus the other, especially on the side that he tore that hamstring. Because if he doesn't, he might end up with like what I had, where I started to push the load, I actually partially tore the opposite side in the competition as it came through because it was doing more of the work than the other side. So I only realized this shortly before the meet, unfortunately, is what I've been working on since the meet is getting my left hamstring up to par with my right hamstring so I can come out of the hole more evenly. So a lot of single leg work. There's some great stuff from David Gray Rehab on how to actually feel and activate your hamstrings. There's a lot of stuff using the wall, like a 90-90 hip lift on the wall, but then doing it single leg and then doing like a calf raise off the wall where you're in that 90-90 from single leg. You can really feel your hamstring work, and it's working in the same position it would be in a squat. And I'm trying to progress. Like initially, I couldn't even do a single leg bridge on a foam roller unsupported. I didn't have any strength. It wouldn't work. So I've gotten to a point where I'm doing single leg bridges off of a foam roller where I have it supported by the wall. I'm up to like 20 reps per leg. I still can't do it single leg unsupported, but I can do multiple reps unsupported with bilateral two legs.
Yeah.
So these are the things he has to work on, is bringing up the hip extension deficiency that he's going to have on that one side through the single leg work. That'll be just as important as how he's loading the actual bar. And he mentioned in his question to us, because you read it to me before, that he does have some stiffness and soreness where the adductor was. And that's because what's left of it is trying to do the job that's not happening by the hamstring. So if I neglect that hamstring health, I have the same problem. I'll start to feel that adductor tie-in area where a little bit of the tendon is left, even though the muscle belly is gone, start to pull. And it's not really dangerous because it's not doing its job, but just making you aware that you are deficient somewhere else. So before he focuses on loading the bar more, I want him to bring up a deficiency on that torn side from hip extension, from glute, and from hamstring, because they now have to compensate for the missing adductor. That should be his primary focus. And as that gets more comfortable and gets strong, then he can slowly and gradually, linearly build up the weight he's using on the squat.
Yeah. Whenever I hear something like this, and then they say they're working back up and they're having the same kind of issues, that just tells me, yes, you may have been injured. Yes, you may have gone to PT. And they may have rehabbed that injured area, but you still haven't fixed the root cause of why you got injured in the first place, because it's right. happening all over again. So like Trevor said, you need to really find that deficiency of what is causing those issues to arise. And if your PT is not kind of giving you the heads up of where that's happening, then doing a lot of the single leg stuff that Trevor was talking about, any type of isolation movements you can do is going to allow you to see where there's a huge discrepancy in weaknesses. So the way he is telling you to do it makes a lot of sense. But if that doesn't compute with you, just doing simple single leg things like a single leg curl, right? And with the machine mm-hmm. or single leg extension, anything like that is going to allow you to see where those deficiencies are happening. You may have deficiencies within pelvic stability, which is adductus magnus stabilizes the pelvis. So if you're having issues there, you want to check that, you know, the bracing, anything that can cause a downhill effect to where you're losing stability within the hole. And then your adductor has to take over to create that stability, because it's a little ass muscle. And if you're squatting mid sevens and that's the thing that's fucking stabilizing you, of course it's going to pop off. Right.
Yeah.
So, you know, Trevor speaking specifically to what happened to him. Try those things out. If you find that, hey, my hamstrings are good to go, then you have to work something else out, right? There has to be a deficiency there that's causing this issues to arise. And I would say maintain whatever volume threshold you're at that allows you to train hard, but doesn't continue to aggravate it until you figure out what those deficiencies are. Because if you don't, then you're going to end up like Trevor, where, yeah, you may be able to train and get ready for a meet, but it's the other side's going to compensate, and it's eventually going to have issues on the other side. We see that all the time with ACL rehabs or Achilles rehab, mm-hmm. where they just rehab the injury, but they don't fix what the cause was. So then the other leg snaps up and it's like, you know, the idea of like, I just here to fix the injury. There's more too. You have to have a holistic approach of why this injury occurred in the first place. And I think that's kind of what Trevor was getting at too.
Yes, 100%, because you're fond of saying it, because I know Bridgeford has told me a million times when we were talking over the weekend that since he tore his one quad, you're like, well, now the other one has a chance of tearing as well if you don't fix the deficiency.
Yeah, for sure, because you see it all the time, man.
You see it all the time. The other side then goes, like someone has torn one bicep and they switch their mixed grip, but they haven't fixed the deficiency, so they tear the other bicep. It's what happens. And so, you know, I got that warning sign in the meat of my right adductor slightly going. Which I've recovered from now, but that was the warning sign that I needed to really focus on the deficiencies more than I was focused on the loads. I've just been very slowly progressing my loads back up and really focusing every morning. I come in here, if it's not my leg day, the first thing I do is that single leg bridge work and the single leg wall work to try and activate my hamstring and my hip extension as much as possible and work on my pelvic stability so that doesn't happen.
Yeah. So hopefully your rehab starts to kick up, man. You get back into the 700, 800 pound squat. And hopefully things start to feel better. So next question, because we do have the holidays coming up. So this is a great question. And it kind of ties into another question we have. So we'll answer both of those kind of back to back. How do you guys approach the holidays with nutrition clients? I know you don't really do nutrition clients per se, but that doesn't mean you don't know nutrition. You've been doing this for X amount of years.
I used to manipulate
a bunch of weight. Yeah, you used to do nutrition absolutely. All the time. So I think people forget that about you. You're a very talented man. That's why you're on 5 podcasts in 1 week. But yeah, so
I used to, and I hated it because the follow through is so poor with nutritionists.
That's because you suck as a coach. If you just give them Snickers and donuts and just have them, just starve the rest of the day, they'll follow it every time.
The buy-in for powerlifting training and programming is so much higher than it is for nutrition. You know, people tell you their goal is to lose this amount or to make this weight class, but then their behaviors and actions say something entirely different. So as a personal development zealot, I hate that. When somebody is like sleeping until noon, but telling you they're a go-getter, it's like, no, you're not. You're missing half the fucking day.
No, they're night owls. I'm just a night owl.
Yeah, I do my work at night when everybody else is sleeping. Like, you fucking play Xbox at night.
Yeah, you're on Netflix tonight. You're doing some bullshit.
Yeah. But to me, I'm like, okay, first of all, the holidays and family get-togethers, you should enjoy. Now, I look at it this way. Do you have a contest coming up or you need to make weight to perform at a certain thing? If so, we might place some, I don't want to say restrictions, but maybe some guidelines. You know, this is how much you can go off on that particular time. I want you to enjoy your family. I don't want you to alienate anyone, that kind of thing. If they don't have a contest or anything coming up, there really isn't that much to worry about if they have a fun family meal. Now, when I say that, a fun family meal, that doesn't mean for the entire week of Thanksgiving, eat everything you possibly can.
True.
That's not a cheap meal. That's a fucking off the rails cheap week. And that's not the same as, okay, my mom makes a great, you know, whatever cake I'm going to have, the turkey, she'll love you for it. So if you have a contest coming up, it's like, okay, maybe we're having one or two indiscretions on that day to enjoy your family time, not make it weird or awkward. You can deal with a 500 to 1,000 calorie surplus in one day. It's just going to cause some temporary water gain. We've seen that scientifically studied. Like if you raise your calories like 1,000 calories above maintenance for 3 days, it's almost very negligible, the actual amount of fat gain. It's predominantly water gain and bloat that comes with it. And then you can get rid of that just by cleaning right back off. So one day is not going to harm.
I've seen somebody eat enough to where they can get fat in a meal. That's for sure.
You've been watching me eat again.
You did eat a whole large pizza, yeah, but did you have anything else to add? Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, that's literally what it would be is people make a mountain out of a molehill. And it's really not that big a deal to have 1,000 calorie surplus on one day if it means your family gets to enjoy yourself. And from the mental aspect, you didn't have the restriction on it that you got to enjoy the holiday, which is what it's about, getting together with your family, doing something and being thankful or whatever. If you have a contest coming up, maybe you restrict a little bit less. If you don't have a contest coming up, by all means, enjoy the family. But I wouldn't sweat it so much because one bad meal doesn't make a bad, you know, week, but it doesn't make a bad result. It's one meal. If you have 7 bad meals, you know, like every day of that week, you start having chocolate bunnies and cakes and pies and whatever, That's different. That means you just have zero discipline
sounds
whatsoever.
So good.
I think I still have like a chocolate Easter bunny in my closet that I bought for like Titus and he hasn't eaten yet. I should go bite its head off. It's delicious. It's Cadbury, I think.
That is a good one for sure.
But that's the biggest thing is people will stress about it because they're very, very meticulous and goal oriented. And I think you're going to gain more from actually stressing about it from a cortisol release than you probably would from that 500 to 1,000 calorie surplus. Don't make a big deal out of it. Relax for one meal.
Not only that, but the stress and the deprivation you create for that one meal over the course of a week, just thinking about it, is going to probably cause you to go off the rails.
Yes.
Some other day or some other week. So the things I would tell my nutrition clients is one, don't worry about it. But two, right, if your idea of having a good time is you have to stuff your face, that's really not spending time with your family, right? Like spending time with your family and having a good time with your family doesn't mean you have to eat three plates of Thanksgiving food, right? Like, so that's just the psychologically, that's a negative correlation that we tend to give the holidays is like, oh, it's a good time only if I can eat this food and this amount of food, right? Because it's the one time a year it's there. So, and it's that whole like, you know, deprivation thing of this is, you tell yourself this is the one time of the year. It's like, no, you can fucking have turkey and ham any other day of the week.
They sell it at the grocery store
all the time. It's very much available. It's easy to access. So it's like, you know, wrapping your head around like, well, what does a good time mean with my family? Does that mean having great conversations, telling jokes, socially interacting, when it's time to eat, having a meal, you know, eating with them, right? Because, I mean, it's what do you usually have at these holidays? You usually have some good sources of protein. You usually have some carbohydrates. You usually have some vegetables. And then you have some desserts. Like, it's not a bad meal. The only time it's a bad meal is when you have like five of those plates and you're just, you know,
overconsumption.
Right. Then you fall asleep and then you feel like shit and you don't really get to spend time with your family anyways. So don't worry about it. Like Trevor said, if you do have stuff coming up, like I said, there are good, like just, you know, have some green bean casserole and some turkey, right? You can still eat and participate and do all that if that's a big thing for you. There's still going to be some good choices there. You don't need to bring a scale and weigh things out. You know, if you're really trying to restrict yourself, just eat a bunch of protein, right? You're going to get fuller faster and you're probably not going to get fat eating protein. But don't try to push the limits of, I'll show you how fat I can get by eating protein. But just understand, right? Like Trevor said, this is a holiday season. Right. This can go downhill really fast. That's why this is like when people put the most weight on is this time of the year. So don't start on Thanksgiving and then end a shit show in December. Right. And then be like, I'm just going to start on the new year. That's just such a negative path. Those aren't the habits that you built throughout the. So just remember the habits you built, you know, food selection, what food is, what hunger really is, satiety, things like that. Remember those habits you built, continue to implement them. If you really are going to have a stressful day about it, try to get some training in before you eat. That'll help partition things a little bit better. Train the next day. You know, those type of things will make you feel a little bit better. If you do eat a little bit too much, make sure the next day you drink a bunch of water to kind of flush everything out because you are going to hold a lot of water and you're going to feel like shit. But yeah, don't stress about it. Set guidelines. That's a really good thing that Trevor said. Give yourself guidelines of what you expect from yourself and then just kind of don't deviate from those guidelines, you know? So if it's like, I'm going to allow myself to eat whatever I want, but it's only going to be on one plate, right? And just allow that to be the case, right? Or be like, I'm going to have protein and veggies and that's it. So I can have desserts. It's like, that's fine. Like, you know, just set
from
the guidelines.
From a scientific perspective, you're going to have the same satisfaction from tasting something that you will from devouring something. I know that doesn't necessarily make sense to a lot of people, but if you
have more, to be honest with you,
you'll get the same dopamine spike. You can have a small sliver of pie, get the taste of it versus eating the entire pie. So if you're eating to a point where you're now in pain, you know,
or you don't even understand like how good the food is anymore. You're just like eating it to eat it.
Yeah.
You ask yourself those questions, right? Those are important questions to raise awareness for that. But yeah, enjoy the holidays. Don't overly stress about it. Worst case scenario, you were good the rest of the year and you just fucked up and you got to build these habits for next year. But
yes,
it's not that big of a deal. And then it kind of goes into the next question. that we have. Is it a good idea to take a fat burner appetite suppressant to get back on track after a binge? And the answer is no, obviously, right? It's like, you know, obviously binging is going to raise ghrelin. It's going to probably make you sleep shitty. It's probably going to fuck up your gut. And that's going to cause a lot of issues with you wanting to continue to eat highly palatable foods, which makes you continue that binge. So by suppressing your appetite and doing all that type of stuff and trying to starve yourself the next day, it's probably going to cause you to binge again because you're doing some type of starvation thing to make up for it. Never make up for a bad, it's like equated to powerlifting, right? Like if you miss the lift in the gym, are you going to go back the next day and try that same exact lift and expect it to like be a great idea? No, of course not. I mean, some idiots will do it and they may get it, but they'll pay for it later. Trust me. So yeah, it's the same thing. If you fuck up eating, just start your day back over like it's just a regular day. And I know that's what happens with a lot of people. They'll binge and then the next day they try to deprive themselves. They'll do extra hours of cardio to make up for it. It's like, don't have that mindset, right? Don't, because then you're going to create this all or nothing mentality. And that's not good either. It's like, should you be binging in the first place? If you're binging, then there's some type of food psychological issue. Maybe you're depriving yourself too much, right? And that happens a lot with people on meal plans where they're like, I can only eat this kind of food because that's what my meal plan says. And then it's like restricting everything. But if you're following macros or even if you're following calories, you know, say you're at 3,000 calories, you can have a fucking slice of pizza every single day and stay within 3,000 calories, right? And you're not depriving yourself. I think that's what happens. So when you say a binge, you have to ask yourself, well, why am I binging? How can I fix these issues with binging? Why do I have such a negative connotation with binging and food and stuff like that? And it's usually because you're depriving yourself and you're creating these issues where you put this food in such a high pedestal that you're never going to get it. So when you do have one bite, it's like, oh, this is the fucking best thing ever. I better finish this whole entire thing and be a fat, gluttonous pig like Trevor eating his fucking whole pizza in California.
You're real jealous of that entire meatball pie in one serving, aren't you?
I didn't even know what kind of pie it was. But now that you said meatball pie, I'm not too jealous at all.
Delicious. California pizza is amazing. Yeah, I mean, you really want to avoid that negative feedback loop. And that's what happens when people try to suppress something, is it's going to come back with vengeance. You know, you're suppressing your appetite now, and then what's going to happen later when that wears off? You can't just keep taking more because usually they're stimulant based, so they'll keep you up all night. And then your body feels deprived and it feels stressed. And what does it want to do to kill the stress? Is eat. So you're creating a feedback loop and you start repeating the same behavior over and over again. So usually when I go out of town on the weekend, I don't really worry about what I'm eating. I just make sure that I am eating so I fuel myself. And as soon as I get back, like you said, I go to a point where I drink more water to flush out the bloat and I go right back to my normal eating schedule. And the first day is usually on the rough side because my body, the ghrelin's high, it wants the junk food I've eaten when I've traveled. But literally after the first day, that urge is gone. The urge is gone at the first day. I've gotten right back to my habits that I've built up, right back to my routine, right back to having chicken, corn, and rice, or whatever it is, with my abundance of teriyaki sauce, because that's my vice, is teriyaki sauce. Yeah.
It's a good vice.
Teriyaki's so good.
It is.
And it's sodium loads me and I'm ready to go for the workout. But that's usually what it is the second you get back to your routine and your habits, your body learns that's your routine and that's your habits and forgets about the cravings. It forgets about the urges. Is where the feedback is not the direction. If you're either trying to suppress it or you're constantly feeding into it, that's going to become your new habit. Your new habit becomes binging. Your new habit becomes purging. Yeah. And those are not healthy habits to have. And they're certainly not performance habits. Because like you said, we flew back Monday and I tried the workout Monday night to do my accessories that I missed on Sunday when we were training out there to try to do my accessories. They felt like death. These things should be easy. But because I was so bloated and off my diet and off my routine, my accessories just felt like garbage. And they were like an RPE 10 at weights that should be like an RPE 5. Yeah. So it certainly doesn't help performance at all to do that. But by Tuesday, I went back to my normal diet. I ate well, working out with Phil Wednesday, yesterday, which was yesterday. I felt fantastic because after 2 days of cleaning the bloat out, like my weight's right back to where it was, I feel great. I'm back in my habits. I'm in my routine. I'm drinking water again, and I have cleaner, healthy foods. I always look at that like, yes, you can make certain foods fit your macros, but do you perform well on them? I know what I perform well off of.
No.
Pizza is not my performance food per se.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, as a performance athlete, that's important, right? Because like if you do suppress your appetite the day after and you don't eat, well, what happens to training that day? What happens training the next day? It's just going to go down the shitter. So you're letting one meal, one binge meal dictate a week's worth of training almost. So it's just not worth it. eat to perform. And if you do make a mistake, just don't even worry about it and just continue to eat to perform, whether it be the next meal or the next day, however you want to do it. But the idea should be, as soon as you eat off plan in your mind, whatever that means to you, right? If you're following macros, there is no off plan. It's just, you know, but if you overeat, it's like, well, that's just one meal. I can get back on track immediately. Yep. And that's the way you should approach it. Next question, sir. You have them.
All right. I got a couple questions here. Let me go to this first one. We talked about it. I'm a new lifter and I struggle to recognize what accessories variations have a good carryover to the comp list for me. I am getting better at identifying my weaknesses, and I have a coach who can tell me what typically works for people with those weaknesses. But how can I know or tell if something is actually working for me? My thought is the answer is likely program it for 3 months, and if you come back better in that weakness, it's probably worked. But just curious if there are any other ways or advice for this. Thank you. And I think she's on the right track there. I don't know if 3 months is necessary for one particular movement, but if you've identified weaknesses, there's usually a checklist you go through. Like, just easy example, you'd say this, you know, someone's weak in the quads and the squat. I tend to think of high bar squats or front squats or squats with the heels raised to really emphasize and focus on quads or whatever. But if that's not working, like after, let's say, a whole block of 6 weeks and you've been doing this quad focus high bar squatting and it's not really helping or transferring over, then, you know, maybe that wasn't the issue. So you kind of go through a checklist of, let's first look at the possibilities of which muscles may need to come up as far as strengthening. Are they progressing under load? So that's why I usually prefer linear-based programs, because you can see if they're progressing under load, if someone's showing an improvement in them. And if it's not transferring over that point or we're not seeing improvement, maybe I need to look a little harder at identifying. Maybe it isn't muscular weakness. Maybe it's functional weakness. And what I mean by that is maybe it's the way they're rooting their feet. Maybe it's the way they're bracing. Maybe it's a mobility restriction and how they're holding the bar that forces them into a certain direction that may represent itself as weak quads, but really it's just a poor position. So I usually will start with the muscle group first. And if they don't see an improvement from focusing on the muscle group, then I know it's probably a pattern or position issue. And I need to look a little harder to find out what's causing it. Which is hard to do when you're online because you don't always get the best film angles of that. But eventually it will show itself over time what it actually is. But she's on the right track of focusing on the muscle groups first, because that's the big picture. And then little nitpicks along the way of those accessory movements to see if you're performing them well.
Yeah. And then, I mean, if you're doing competition lifts year round and you're doing some type of wave periodization or progressive overload, that should be a good indicator if you're making progress immediately. But let's say you're not doing that. Let's say you're just doing some type of variation. That's why it's important to not have variations be so extreme, so that you do understand that they're having a carryover. If you're doing a safety squat, reverse band, box squats with four chains, like that's one hell of a setup. 30 minutes after setting that up and you do your first set, it's like, well, that's probably not going to carry over to anything that you do. So then you just, then you're just kind of shooting in the wind. Then you're kind of CrossFit and powerlifting, where it's just like, let's just throw some random shit at a wall and hope we improve our fitness level. It's like, probably not the best approach. So keep the variations close to your lift. That way you can understand, like, okay, well, these accessories are driving this variation. This variation, if it improves, my main lift usually improves. But there needs to be some type of indicator within your training to allow you to know that you're progressing, right? Because what's the point of doing a lift if there's, you know, say your coach, I don't know who your coach is, but like, let's say your coach is having you bench 225 for three sets of five, an entire block. It's like, well, how do you know you're improving? It's like, right. Well, I don't know. That's going to be tough. But if you're doing 225 for three sets of five, and then the next week you do 245 for three sets of five, that tells me that the volume you've chosen is good, the accessories you've chosen is good, and your recovery is good. So just continue to repeat whatever you did that week, whether it be sleep, hydration, food, and then all those accessories, because that's driving you in the right area to progress, then that's going to be important. So having those indicators that allow you to see progressions happening within training is very important, right? You should be trying to progress your lifts in some capacity, whether it be improving the speed of it, improving the technique of it, improving execution and techniques are the same thing, or improving the actual load. You know, this idea of like, I don't know. I'm not a huge fan of improving volume is necessarily going to always equate to improving overall strength, right? If you're not actually improving the load on the bar, is that really going to make you a stronger lifter just because you're accumulating a bunch of volume? I don't necessarily think that that's always the case with powerlifting, and maybe more of the case with bodybuilding, but with powerlifting, there has to be some type of weight progression going on. And that should be the important thing that you look at. You know, not so much with the accessories, but if you have compound movements, they should be progressing in some type of manner, whether it be linearly, if you're doing that type of programming, or whether it be, cause some people will squat heavy 1 week and then squat light the next week. Both those weeks should have some type of progression scheme to them so that you know that you're moving in the right direction. It's like people that do cardio and they just do 20 minutes four times a week and they never change that. And you think, well, I'm just going to get lean off of this. It's like, something has to fucking change. Like there has, you got to do something, right? To
your body adapts. Yeah. Right, it gets more efficient at that. And then all of a sudden you're burning less total calories in that four times 20 minutes because you've gotten more efficient at it until you have a different stimulus. So, you know, that different stimulus can, on a treadmill, for example, if you're doing four sessions of 20 minutes each one, and you start at 3.0, you know, if after 3 weeks you're still at 3.0, you have made zero progression in there. You haven't even tried to. So your body's gotten efficient at it. You know, something as simple as going 3.1 all of a sudden adds a different variable. So, that's what Tony's kind of, you know, leading at here. If you start a program at 3x5 at 70% and for 10 straight weeks, you just add a set and all of a sudden now you're doing 10x5 at 50% or 75%. That's just adding a ton of volume, but it isn't necessarily adding strength. It's just adding more time under tension at a certain load, which makes more sense for bodybuilding than it does for powerlifting over time. So you're looking at those indicators, which it kind of leads us to Dalton's question as well. I'll segue into this.
Before we get into that, I think another thing too is like Trevor was saying, say you get back into this lift and the idea, I guess it's the idea, like, can you really improve your weaknesses to the point where they're not your weaknesses anymore?
Right.
And that takes, if it ever happens, first off, that takes a very long time. Like morphologically, if you're built, like for me, I have shorter arms and a bit of a longer torso shorter torso, but long femurs. So my squat's always going to it's never going to be upright. That's for sure. And my deadlift, the lockout's always going to be fucking hard. So I can train the shit out of my deadlift, but my lockout is always going to be the weakest link for me. So maybe that's not necessarily an indicator of if you're improving the lift to improve your weaknesses too, right? So technically you may be missing a lift at your knees. So the person's like, oh, I got to train everything at my knees. And it's like, that doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get stronger at your biomechanically, morphologically, like least advantageous position, right? So it's just the idea of understanding what's going to make you stronger. And it's not always necessarily training within that specific range of motion that you're missing the lift on. So I know a lot of people fall into that. And I think that was a geared lifting thing where it's like, oh, I miss it like 2 inches off my chest. So I should just do two board presses all the time. It's like, maybe not, right? Maybe that's not why you're actually missing it 2 inches off your chest. Maybe there's some other reasons behind that. So don't necessarily make the movements be so specific to the areas that are causing the issues as well. It's the last thing I wanted to touch on.
Everyone stopped doing rack pulls now. Like, wait a minute. It's not making me stronger. It's killing my back. All right, cool. All right. So Dalton kind of asked the question along the same lines of how would you balance a lifter's weaknesses and strengths within their programming. And it kind of falls along the same lines as, you know, if you are coming off of a meet and you've identified their weaknesses, maybe you put those up front, but not at the expense of their strengths. And what I mean by that is if you've decided that you need to say front squat, because front squat is a weakness as far as keeping your torso, like Tony mentioned, his torso angle is going to lean. So a front squat might benefit him because he's going to be able to work on thoracic extension under load, but it would negate his strength, which is his hips and his quads. So if he were to only front squat, he's never giving a significant load to his legs. It might benefit him to lead the way with the front squats to work on his weakness. And the secondary movement now might be a squat variation where he's using a load that's still going to challenge his quads and his hips and the whole nine, or maybe even front squat to build the torso, but then overload with, say, a belt squat, you know, something like that that's allowing him to train the legs. But he's, while he's freshest, he's hitting his weakness first. That's the mistake most people make, is they only identify the weakness and they completely forget to train their actual strengths, which is what got them there in the first place.
Yeah.
You see it a lot with, I was talking with Reed, one of Joe Sullivan's lifters at the Surge New Levels seminar I did with Greg. And he was talking about that. And because even though my primary pull right now is conventional, because I'm trying to build my low back strength, I don't completely avoid my sumo. I have no sumo in my program at the moment from Matt, but it doesn't mean I avoid it. When I went to California and I did some deadlifts, I did it extra, or one time, or other times I might warm up both sumo and conventional to keep my pattern. And it's very common for someone who's doing a sumo deadlift to say, my low back needs to come up, let me do all conventional. And they completely negate their strength, which is a sumo pull in the first place. They don't train it. And all of a sudden they're like 8 weeks out from the meet, and then sumo feels like shit because they haven't trained it at all. So it's one of those things where you still want to keep that motor pattern and maybe touch on it, maybe do a back offset with a little bit lighter load at sumo just to maintain the position. But you have the right ideas. Okay, if you need to bring up your low back strength, you're focusing primarily on conventional, but not at the expense of your strength, which is sumo. And you see that a lot with bench press as well. Like you mentioned, I'm missing at lockout, I'm only going to train two board. Well, then you get weak at the bottom because you've never trained your strength. So it starts with identifying the weakness, prioritize that as the first lift, make the secondary something that maybe even is extended range. So so if you're missing at lockout, maybe you're prioritizing with that two board, nice and heavy, allows you to overload the top men. But maybe your secondary work is extended range, like a Buffalo bar bench press, to make sure that you can use less load but still get stronger from the bottom. And then you're moving the weight even further range. So you've overloaded the top and now you're moving further range. You're hitting it from all angles, as opposed to something, let me just two board bench press and hope that it clears up the problem. But then they never train the bottom. And that's the mistake that people make, is they only focus on the weakness and don't identify that the strength still needs to be there too.
Yeah. And that's, Trevor, coming from like a technical perspective, right? Which makes a lot of sense. You don't want to lose your technical proficiency because that's one of the biggest drivers of the sport, right? Mm-hmm. If your sport is powerlifting to where you, that's like telling a football player, hey, don't do anything athletic in your off season to become better at football. Just stay on the couch and lift weights and see how good that does, right? But then you also have to take into consideration the actual like mechanical tension that you're trying to produce as well. So if you just focus on your weakness, say like to go with Trevor's example, front squat. Say your front squat is your best front squat's like 315 for a set of five. But your best back squat is 555 for a set of five, right? If you only stay with that front squat and that 315 load range, your fucking back squat is going to start to come down to meet it because you're not able to stress those same muscles with that same type of load. So then that's going to create a problem as well. So you can go with the strategy Trevor said, which is a great strategy. You can also go with building up your weaknesses as accessory movements after your main movement as well, as long as you're weaknesses aren't a deficiency that can cause an injury. I don't see that being an issue as well. But you don't want to neglect either one of them, right? If you're, it's like saying, you know, if you're really good at Muay Thai and you're an MMA fighter and you're like, don't ever do Muay Thai again. It's like, well, that's what I'm the best at. Why wouldn't I continue to train that as well and get better? Continue to refine the tools that you already have mastered, because trust me, you don't have a mastered first off. And two, like that's the most important, specificity is the most important thing when it comes to sports in terms of barbell sports, right? You have to learn the movements and get stronger at those movements. So never neglect them. Cause we see that with that's one of the biggest downfalls of conjugate is specificity.
Too much variation.
Yeah. Too much variation. And then, you know, if your variations are so limited in your ability to actually handle heavy loads, you're not going to get stronger either. So if there is a huge deficiency in a movement, say front squat was extremely weak compared to your back squat, then maybe just back squat first, continue to get that stronger, and then try to build up your front squats as an accessory, because it's such a weaker lift that it's not going to fatigue you. I wouldn't consider that like a highly fatiguing compound movement because it's so much weaker than your other ones.
Yes. And you can drop the volume of the main lift. What I mean by that is, if you've already got a shot, like you said, the example of a squat where it's 550 for five versus a front squat 315 for five, maybe you have just one top set of squats and then three to four sets of the front squat. So you're building a volume within the weaker lift, but you're just doing enough to kind of maintain your strength there while building up the weaknesses. And that's where people also go wrong, is they try and put the volume for everything. And there's a ceiling to how much volume you can actually handle. So all of a sudden it's like five back squat sets, five front squat sets, five sets of lunges. It's like, well, if you're training legs once a week, you can probably get away with that. But most of us nowadays are doing things two or three times a week. So it gets to be excessive.
Yeah. And then that kind of answers the previous question too, right? Like say you are doing a set of five back squat with 555 and that's just your first set. And then you're doing all your accessories, right? And then maybe the next time you do that back squat and you go to 575 for a set of five and it felt just like it did at 555, that's going to tell you, hey, I'm making progress, right? So those are the type of things that you want to look at when trying to understand weaknesses, deficiencies, and if they're actually progressing you in the right manner. But yeah, if you're in your off season, you know, you just have to do the movement at least once to twice a week, right? Just touch it. You'll keep that proficiency down. You'll get stronger. You'll even maybe notice like if your weaknesses are starting to shift or imbalances, right? If you have an imbalance in a lift, if you have an imbalance in a squat and it only presents itself when you're doing a low bar squat, well, how do you know you're fixing that imbalance unless you actually low bar squat to see if that is getting fixed, right? You know, so don't necessarily shy away from those things just because you're in your off season and you feel like you need some type of variation or because you're trying to minimize risk of injury from overuse stuff. Well, overuse right. stuff is just don't do as much volume as you normally do. That's
cut the volume.
That's
down
the same thing as,
minimum.
The idea right, like, that a variation is going to help prevent overuse injury. Last time I checked, any type of squat, you're going to have some fucking knee bend to it. You're going to have some hip extension. So it's not like you're doing a completely different new movement, you know? So I don't really understand the overuse principle a lot of times when it comes to that stuff.
Yeah, I mean, overuse is going to happen.
I think it's more not a volume driver, right? It's not, yeah, it's not an exercise selection.
No, it's volume. It's volume drivers overuse, and sometimes it's pattern and positioning. Like, you know, a lot of people will jam themselves into a low bar squat and force their hands real narrow and compress themselves down so they get the bicep tendonitis. That might be a little bit different, but you're talking about like ankles, knees, and hips. If you're doing a high bar squat or you're doing a low bar squat, your ankles, knees, and hips are taking the same movement, the same volume. Right. And that's the decision. So, yeah, I mean, you don't always need to take that competition grip or that competition form. You can work similarly close to it or use a specialty bar. A Cambridge bar or a Buffalo bar or Yukon bar that kind of eliminates some of that compression.
What's a Yukon bar?
Yukon bar is like Titan's version of the Duffalo. It has the higher camber curve than the Buffalo bar is like a small curve and the Yukon bar is the big Duffalo style curve.
I wish they would just keep them all the same fucking name and just put the name of the company in front of it. Like Titan bent bar. It's like, okay, now I know which one. You got to give these fucking fancy names. I don't keep up with any of that stuff anymore.
Yeah, well, if you don't want to pay $620 for a Duffalo bar plus shipping Titan because it's only like $220.
You should buy everything from like Elite FTS first off. We do not promote any other manufacturers in this podcast. All right. So yeah, if you guys ever want to get sponsored by a company and you want to learn how to lose your sponsorship, promote their competitors is the greatest way to do that. So next question, how to retain online clients? They get results, but somehow they drop. Results aren't the only thing that's going to keep a client around. Any coach can get a client results for the most part if they're a smart coach. The communication, the community, the fact that they know that you truly care about them, that you want them to succeed, understanding their goals and being able to communicate with that with them and understanding, you know, to let them know that, hey, we're going from point A here and then point B and then point C so that way we'll get to your goal eventually, like mapping these things out. Communication, you know, if your client tags you to tell them, hey, good job, repost them, like those type of things may not mean a lot to you as a coach. You may just think like, okay, I liked it, no big deal. But it's like that person may have tagged you just because they want some type of approval from you. You are their coach. You should approve right. of their stuff. And that's not a bad thing. That's not a deficiency on that athlete. They hired you for a reason. And results are one of the reasons, but it's also, they liked who you are. They like what you represent. And if you just kind of shove them off and push them to the side, like, oh, this person's getting great results, they're going to continue to stay with me. Then they're going to start to feel neglected. And it doesn't really matter what results they have. I know someone who added 100 pounds to their total working with this coach. And he said, the training was too hard and I didn't have enough time to continue it. And his coach would never adjust it because he was getting great results. So why should they adjust the program? It's like, cause your fucking client just told you he can't handle it. Like Jesus Christ, like he doesn't want to spend 4 hours in the gym. Can you blame the guy? Like, no, of course not. So as a coach, you can't have these like dead set rules of, hey, we're making progress, so nothing's going to change. If your client's telling you to change stuff, right? Like I have this one client, we're making really good progress and he has his dissertation coming up. So from the month of the end of September until last week he did his dissertation, we just dropped training down to 3 days a week so he can fucking work on that stuff. And it's like, that's just what you have to do, right? You have to be able to communicate those things, but continue to give them those results, right? It's not just a results-driven business. It's a people business. It's a, you know, person to person. You have to be a personable human being. And coming from me, that's a fucking long shot because I'm the most unpersonal human being you'll ever meet. But
a little cold, a little callous.
I go out of my way as much as I can to, you know, make my clients understand, like, I care about their results because I honestly do. I want to see them be successful. I want to help them out. And I want them to know that I care about them. I want them to know, like, hey, just because I haven't emailed you doesn't mean I'm not thinking about your questions, right? Doesn't mean I'm not thinking about the email you sent me. Doesn't mean we have check-ins on Monday and Thursdays for my nutrition clients. Just because it's not a Monday or Thursday doesn't mean I'm not thinking about how can we make you progress to get better? What are some of the things that you did on the check-in that we can continue to improve on so that I can get back to you? Like, those things matter and people understand that and they see that. And if they see how much you work for them, then they're going to love being around you and they're going to continue to hire you as a coach. And I think that's extremely important. And don't also neglect the people that you've had for a while, right? You've had clients for years. I've had clients for 4 to 5 years. And it's really easy to be like, oh, well, they're just going to stay with me forever. You know, I'll just give them their program. No big deal. We've already talked. The first year we've established. It's like, no, like, you should treat them like they're new clients every single time. Make them feel special. Like, it's a relationship. And you don't want to be the person who, like, never shows up with a fucking bouquet of flowers, right? You got to make the people feel special every now and then.
Do you know how many clients are going to want flowers now, Tony? Damn you. Don't take it personal. Clients, unfortunately, are not forever and for various reasons. Sometimes they lose their job. Sometimes they lose their interest. Sometimes they have different commitments, or sometimes they just want to try a different perspective. Like Tony said, you know, they may have gotten great results, but they see something else that interests them and they just want to try it. I have clients who are friends who've gone to other coaches and we're still friends because I don't take it personal. You know, having owned a training studio for several years, I know that clients aren't forever because, you know, there is an expense to buy in and pay for coaching and do things. And sometimes they're not taking the sport as serious and they don't want to pay for that expense. They just want to coast or cruise through and they come and go. I've had clients who stop for 6 months and come back for a year and then stop for 6 months and come back for a year. It's just like Tony said, the constant communication, let them know you care. You're thinking about them, worried about them, trying to get them result. We all want to see a client's result because that's what they're coming to you for. And it helps you help them if you're seeing a result. If they're not seeing a result or they're struggling, you're really hoping they're telling you why so you can work to fix it and correct it with them. And that's the biggest struggle and sometimes why you lose a client, because not every client knows how to communicate to you the issues they're having or they're struggling with, or maybe they're not comfortable because sometimes it's personal life issues or additional stress. And sometimes you can pick up on that and say, hey, what's going on outside of the gym? Is there anything we could do? I could modify, like Tony, you talked about modifying it 3 days a week, someone who was in a very high stress situation because they have the dissertation coming up. And I've had to do that as well. People tell me things are going on right now. It's season for this, that, and the other thing. And so we've reduced to 3 days, or maybe we've gone from 5 days to 4 days. Or maybe we've gone to like a higher frequency program with less accessories so they can get in and out of the gym more quickly and still get those main lifts in. You have to make a lot of accommodations and adjustments and not be set stuck in a certain way. We all have idealisms of what we'd like to do. 4 hours seems a little excessive in the gym for some people. And Riley was telling me there was a client she took on who was doing that. Basically, they were in the gym for like 3 or 4 hours. And when they first looked at their program that she sent them, they're like, this is it. This is all you want me to do. And the client then like wrote her back after the second session, like, this is plenty. This is enough. Right. I'm walking out tired. You know, if you're intentful and not just throw junk programming at them, they're going to get a result. They're going to feel something. But it also let that client know that Riley cared to make sure that she wasn't beaten into the ground and beaten up, because that's when she came to her, because she was already beaten up from a previous coach. She felt run down and needed something different. And the client really appreciated that she gave her something different, something that was tailored to her. And it took into account what she said in the questionnaire. Like, listen, I'm really overworked. I'm really beaten up. And realized that she needed to do half the volume, but more intentful work. And that's just something you're constantly going to work at. So clients, unfortunately, aren't always going to last forever for various reasons. Don't take it personally. It isn't personally usual. It's something else. But if you can continue to provide them something that keeps them there, that comes from communication. You know, what more can I do to help you? What can I do to further progress you? What can I change within the programming that's going to help you adhere to it or stick to it? This is why I hated nutrition, because people didn't stick to it the same way they would for powerlifting.
Yeah.
Powerlifting programming, everybody loves to lift. They love going to the gym. They love that environment. So they'll usually tell you what they're struggling with I just had a similar thing. One of my female clients, she was on a 4-day week program, and she let me know that, hey, I'm finishing up. I'm in this advanced master's program. I got to commit this amount to school, and I got to commit this amount to work. And we lost an employee, so I have to cover their slack. Same thing you did. Dropped her down to 3 days a week. And now we did that for like 2 months. And that she messaged me like 2 weeks ago. Everything can go back to normal. Things are good. We hired an employee. I'm done with this semester of school. Can we go back to 4 days a week? Good on her for letting me know that, because I was able to change it to what she needed. And that just comes from a great client communication. So we always talk about this. When a client gives us one word or one sentence answers to our questionnaires, you usually know that that's a red flag. That's not a client you want to work with.
Yeah.
So it starts setting yourself up from choosing the right clients who communicate, instead of getting mad that a client who doesn't have great communication skills 6 weeks later is looking for the door because they just weren't a great remote, a great online client because they lack communication skills. So that's the start. If you're disappointed in your clients leaving fast, I would look at two things. What is their level of communication and what is your level of service to them?
Yeah. And then like Trevor said, and I can't relate this enough, is, you know, it's not a forever thing. Don't get your feelings hurt if a client leaves you and they start working with another coach. Like, that's going to happen. As coaches and athletes, you want to learn from other people. You want to get different perspectives, and that's fine. Right. And that's everyone's, you know, prerogative, but you can't get upset about it, because then you're going to create this like negative, salty environment that you see with a lot of people who are like, oh, online coaching sucks. There's no loyalty. It's like, you're not fucking, you know, going to Iraq and fighting, and you need that loyalty to have somebody watch your back. It's like, it's a business, right? Like, I don't, you know, if it's like, if McDonald's is your favorite restaurant, can you call McDonald's a restaurant? I can't call McDonald's a restaurant.
That is questionable.
Yeah, it's very questionable. But like, say, hey, you went to McDonald's and that's your favorite place. Do you think like for the rest of your life, all you're ever going to do is go to McDonald's? No, you're probably going to go to Taco Bell because they have a fucking new taco with cheese around it and whatever. I don't know. I don't ever eat that stuff. But the fact of the matter is like nothing's forever. Don't take anything personally. And continue to provide support to those people, because you never know when they might come back, right? If if somebody disowns you as a coach, but it's on good term, disowns a bad word. If somebody no longer wants to work with you as a coach, that doesn't mean you're going to block them and like to have negative shit to say about them. No, continue to follow them, continue to support their endeavors, right? Because one, that's what you should want to do, right? You should want to continue to support people that you have built a relationship with. But two, it also shows them like, hey, man, you know, I'm not paying this guy, but he's still fucking there helping me out. I try to do that with all my clients when they leave. I'm like, hey, if you ever have any questions about anything, if you need, like, I'll have nutrition clients where it's like, we've hit our goal. I think you're at a point where you can maintain this on your own. We've built a lot of really good habits. But if you ever need any help with any adjustments or any fine tuning, or if you just have any questions, even if we're not working together, just reach out to me and ask, and we'll make those adjustments and we'll get you back on track. Cause you don't need to rely on me at all for this stuff, but sometimes things happen, but I'm always going to be there for you. Right. And you're building this long-term relationship with that person where they may never work with you again, but they may send you 5 more clients, right? Because you're there for them all the time.
I've had that happen as well. Yeah. Just when we were out in California, somebody I used to work with as a coaching client, Christian Johnson, trains at California Elite Coaching Center, found out I was in town. He messaged me right away and he's like, hey, can I come by in gym? I've never actually met you. You know, even though you coach me, I'd like to meet you. And we had a great conversation. We were talking about his business. He coaches people online and he was offering me like real estate advice if I need to. And he's actually referred people to me before when they've had certain injuries or things that were out of his scope of practice. And it's exactly that. You're maintaining a friendship. You're maintaining a relationship and offering them guidance still. Just because you're not their main coach doesn't mean you're not their mentor, their advisor, their leadership role, whatever it is. So, you know, it's not personal and you can still maintain great relationship with them, which will come back to you eventually in a positive way, or they come back to you when they realize that, you know, maybe I had my best result or my best communication with him.
Yeah, definitely. So great points to think about. I would always say to never blame it on the client. Always try to look inside ways to fix things on your own. Extreme ownership is something that I fully 100% get behind. It's never a bad team. It's usually bad leadership. You're the leader of your business. You're the leader of your clients. Always look to yourself to improve and find the faults in yourself before you start finding the faults in others. But in nutrition, man, it drives me crazy when people are like, you're just cheating on your diet. It's like, for fuck's sake, the evidence-based people are like, well, it's calories in versus calories out. I gave you a diet where the calories are less. If you're not making progress, you're just cheating on your diet. It's like, come on, man. You can't just say that shit to them. You can't just assume that. It's like,
that's the extent of their knowledge, though.
Oh, I know. It drives me crazy, man. It absolutely drives me crazy. But yeah, so thanks for the questions, guys. Really appreciate it. That is, we had some good feedback with having Claire on. So I think, and I didn't talk to you about this, but I am the host, so I make the
now, I've got a microphone and you don't.
I think, I mean, you enjoyed it. I think it'd be cool to have more up and coming coaches on, like maybe every fifth episode or something, every sixth episode. So if you're a coach that wants to come on the show to kind of build your resume or just talk shit with us, send us over, direct message us, you know, kind of your credentials. And if you seem like a good person, we'll have you on. If you seem like an idiot, we'll have you on and make you look like a complete idiot as well to expose you. No shame in that. But I think
so, cool, good person, man. Bad person, we'll still have you on, but we'll directly make fun of you on air.
Yes. Yes. So
got it.
Be ready. But yeah, what do you think about that? You can say no as well and completely ruin, dash everyone's dreams of coming on the show. I love that.
This is the only way I actually get to interact and meet people is through, through podcasting and social media. So sure. This is great.
Yeah.
It allows me to stay home, not get sunburned, and still develop new relationships, contacts, and learn.
Very true. Very true. So, all right. So yeah, if you're an upcoming coach or if you're just a coach in general, I don't care if you have a big following or not, shoot us a message. If you want to come on the show, we'll have you on the show. I'd love to have you on, talk shop and make fun of each other. But
I don't even care if I'm coming. I want some cool old school people who probably never really took to the internet age to come on and tell us we should all sit back and respond.
It's going to be to get some old school person on Skype. It's going to be like an hour before the actual interview, walking them through how to turn their computer on, how to use Skype.
I want someone who's going to tell us that we should be in briefs every other week.
Got to keep those hips. Keep those hips fresh, boys. Yeah.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah, for sure. So appreciate the questions, guys. Really good questions. Holidays are coming up, but I don't really think that should interfere. We just have to podcast on Wednesday. Sound good to you?
Sounds great to me.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, so we'll keep it going, guys. Obviously, if Trevor ever has something going on where he has on vacation with his kids, then I'll get Riley and his better half. But we'll always try to put a podcast out once a week. And if she's that much better than him, then maybe we'll have a new co-host. Who knows? Probably. Send in your applications for new co-hosts, guys.
But you have to be able to talk a lot and a fast. Lot.
Yes, yes. You have to be the complete opposite of my slow, methodical approach to a conversation. Yeah. But yeah, appreciate you guys. If you like the show, leave a review on iTunes, 5-star rating. We're at 126 now, so really appreciate that. It'd be cool to get to 200. But that requires a little bit of effort on your part, guys. So we appreciate it. Thank you so much. Support the companies, Subject Zero Supplements, which may or may not be at the Olympia this year. I don't know. They haven't emailed me back. So fingers crossed.
Oh, nice.
If they email me back and there's a place to have vendors and stuff like that, we may be at the Olympia, which is now in Orlando, Florida.
Orlando.
Super convenient for us. God bless. Is it Mayor DeSantis or is it Governor?
Governor. Yeah. Governor DeSantis. He's like, bring us all your tourism dollars. We'll take your COVID.
I love that guy, man. God, there needs to be more like him freeing up this economy. Support.
He's got the Olympia coming. I think he's trying to get the Super Bowl coming.
Fucking World's Strongest Man was here. All kinds of good stuff, yep. Man. Florida's open. Florida and Texas are the two states that are just fucking cowboying up and like, coronavirus can suck it. Love it. Love it. Iron Rebel, MetroLife, Ritual Apparel, Renaissance Periodization. Support those companies, guys. And make sure that you use code Jaffy10.
Jaffy10.
Jaffy Bananas.
Just Jaffy for Ritual.
Jaffy. Laffy Jaffy. Try them all out.
Any of them work.
Yes, for sure. But yeah, appreciate you guys listening. Continue to send us those questions. We really, really appreciate it. Talk to you guys next week.